Alright, so, hey, again, I'm Robin Baumgarten. I'm based in London, but I'm German. But I'm thinking of moving out of London, so I think that kind of feeds into this, into my kind of passion to talk about location independence a bit. So I'm thinking about kind of taking a year where I just move around, but I haven't done that yet, so I'm going to talk about other people who did that, and also things you can do without moving, just like shorter jaunts, basically, away from home. Yeah, and I'm going to explain this picture in particular later as well. So, first we talk about digital nomads. So that's a bigger phenomenon. And it's mostly, what I've seen so far anyway, it's a cultural phenomenon in the first world. So, you know, because it's kind of expensive, but I'm going into the costs as well and kind of what needs to happen before you can do that. And how experienced you need to be. So I'll talk about a few examples, so you've probably heard of most of them. So this is Colin and Sarah Northway. They've been location independent for 5 years now. So they've moved around mostly in the third world, so Thailand, actually no, they're everywhere. So Thailand, Japan, Turkey, Czech Republic, Italy, Malta, Scotland, France, Honduras, Costa Rica, Panama, Philippines, Argentina, and Brazil. It's from their website. So I haven't really spoken to Colin much, so most of it that I know from him is from his talks about in the GDC. He gave a talk about nomadic lifestyle as well. And so they make all their games abroad, so it's kind of cool. So like each game in different countries, kind of cool. There's Kat Burton. I don't know how well she knows abroad. She used to work for Unity and Mindcandy in the UK. I met her like last week at Burning Man. This is last week. There's Charlie the Unicorn in the background. Burning Man is a crazy thing. It's not quite my wavelength, but it's interesting, definitely. But crazy expensive as well, so I probably won't go again. But yeah, so Kat is also traveling around, so she has been in Thailand, New Zealand. She only started last year and she's back home now. So she's kind of hovering back and forth if she wants to be location independent. So that's her in a hotel room somewhere. Then you all know Rami and Adriel, who's her friend. They're based in the Netherlands, but they kind of move around so much you could almost call them location independent. Adriel's originally from the States, but she's moved over and she's been making lots of games. One game a week last year, and that was quite grueling, I think, she said. So it's interesting. So that brings us to the next part, kind of where to go. That's kind of an interesting question because it also depends where you come from. So there's like visa issues, for example, which I'll go into later. But one resource which is not game-centric, but it's kind of interesting, which I found is called Nomad List. And it's a list of cities that are especially good for digital, like a nomadic lifestyle. So like people who need the internet and want to live cheaper. So I have the website open. Well, actually you can see it all there. So it's a kind of a list and you kind of can adjust your weighting. So if you really need fast internet, right? So you can see the internet like there. Until recently, Chiang Mai was always in the top spot, and they actually have a bit of trouble now. I've read recently that there's like too many people coming there, so it's like they have a strong gentrification and cost explosion going on. So it's actually not without danger, or kind of for the local communities that this kind of move happens. But you see, like Budapest is at least, you know, for Europeans is very close. But then there is a couple of U.S. cities, then Argentina is fairly close up, high up as well, which is not on this page. So that's kind of cool to see where it could go. And then just recently I read an article about Japan. There was like this, wait. Yes. I read an article about this tiny town called Kamijama, which is like down there on one of the small islands, and they only have 6,000 people, but they have like this resurgence of people moving there just in the middle of the Japanese countryside because it's like a good kind of a fertile ground for indies, or like for developers in general. There's a lot of like people go there to work on their own projects. And it seems quite interesting. It's like away from the bus of big cities, and it's much cheaper as well. Well, Japan cheap anyway, so I don't know how cheap that is in like relative to here, for example. Yes, so now I'll talk about a couple of indie communities I've come across. So that's also interesting. Like when you travel around, like you want to visit kind of like-minded people, right? So you want to go to other communities that are big, that are kind of interesting, so you don't feel too alone in your kind of travels. So this is in London. This was a party we had a while back with Mount Rumpus. Actually, fairly similar to like yesterday's French arcade, just a little bit bigger, to be more mature, I guess. Right, so the community I know best is in London, but it's also super expensive, and that's why I consider moving away. But they have a really big indie scene, so that's like we have like a meetup group with over 1,500 members on it, and we have events basically every week. There's a nice bar, the loading bar, it's like kind of a shot of that. And it's a game themed bar, and we can use it for free to co-work during the day, which is kind of cool. And then we just stay over and have a beer or two, so that it kind of is worth it for the bar as well. And they have like, you know, pinball machines, board games. It's a very nice environment to work, except that the tables and the chairs don't match up at night, so it's kind of, it's a bit distractive as well. It's like you work with other indies who come there occasionally, so you talk a lot, but I find the social aspect very nice of it. Here's another shot of the loading bar at like one of the events we had. I think it was just like a summer launch party, so everyone who launched a game in the summer in London could come over and show it off. And kind of get some feedback as well. That was quite nice. Another nice community is in Berlin. I have only visited it briefly, so like two or three times. But it seems to be gaining momentum as well, so that's kind of getting bigger. And they have a lot of events as well. They have a kind of cool museums as well. For example, the Game Science Center is like focused on like weird like games that kind of might predict the future of interaction, like kind of, you know, eye-tracking games. They have a couple other weird custom controllers as well, so it's quite nice. So they have a very fertile scene, and it's much cheaper than London. So Berlin is still one of the cheapest Western European capitals. So like rent is much cheaper, and it's very active as well in the art scene. I like graffiti, so that's like the whole thing. Just graffiti and random stuff in there. Vienna, I've only visited, but apparently it has a good scene as well. So Colin mentioned Vienna specifically as having a really small but very artsy scene. And apparently it's not so expensive, so I don't really know, because I thought Vienna is quite expensive, but I can't really tell too much. But apparently it's a nice and small scene, and they have cool graffiti as well.
I have to throw something in. So in Vienna there's this Wurton, which is kind of the nice thing you do. And in the summer, it's like a weekly meetup. And right now we have those shooting stars guys, and this is really growing.
Yeah.
It's cool. So if you go to Vienna, check out Subotron.
Subotron?
It's the first spot, and then you connect.
All right, yeah. So that's another one for Vienna. Buenos Aires, I haven't been, but it's this Colin's favorite city, apparently, in terms of indie. Kind of indie scene. It's a very tight-knit and experimental crew there, apparently. And it's also very cheap with it. So I'll definitely try to go there at some point. It's just like far away, so I don't. Another really big scene is in Vancouver. So that's like one of the biggest scenes in America, like the continent. So that's really nice, but also I've been. So I just rely on it. Then there's a lot of scenes in the US, so Boston, Austin mainly, they're kind of up and coming and big. San Francisco is like the most fractured and small, but it's way too expensive anyway, so we'll go there. And New York, yeah, I don't know much about the New York scene. They have cool bars and like the barcade, like beer bar and bar machine, nice to go out. Right, so these are kind of the indie scenes. Another way to kind of go away and kind of get new information or new, like, you know, build your game somewhere else are game accelerators. So there's not a lot of those here. There is One that I know is called Game Founders, but they're kind of weird. So that's a 3 month project, 3 month program. But so I don't know if you can, yeah, you probably can't reach it. So they provide like 15,000 euros seed capital, but they want 9% of your company, which I think is a fairly raw deal. But I have never done any kind of deals like this. But everyone tells me like this is actually a lot of money, or a lot of percent for the 3 months of coaching. And apparently it's more focused not on working on your game, but working on everything around it. So like PR, getting good at marketing, you know, getting good at fundraising. And they recently moved from Estonia to Kuala Lumpur, I believe. So that's interesting as well if you fall into this kind of category. They're looking for teams with at least two people, so they don't want one person teams. And you need to kind of have something to show or anything. But so the cool one I want to talk about today as well is called Steuben, and I don't know how many of you have heard of Steuben. So Peter was there, and Joel is also over there, and me. And so this is like this year. It was the first year, and it was about 2 months ago. For 2 months in the Swedish countryside, so in the middle of nowhere in Sweden, and we had these huts. So like all the huts you can see in the background, just like occupied by us, and then we had like a office space as well. And that was kind of interesting in that it was an altruistic effort by the Swedish games industry, or like by certain figures from the industry, to fund indies or to support indies. So it was entirely free for us, and it was entirely sponsored. So accommodation and food were also free. So it was a not-for-profit thing. So that was kind of too nice to be true almost, but I think it worked out. So next year, they're probably gonna run it again, so you should definitely all apply. You will, so they accept teams up to 3 people, like 1 to 3, and any stage of your project. So I had barely got a prototype working, so it's like super early. But other people had worked on the game for 5 years, and they just wanted to finish it up. So you just need to, for this project, you need to kind of set yourself a target. So like, I wanna, you know, release it on Steam, for example. And then you apply and you go there. So I expect the application process to be a bit more competitive next year, because it's now fairly well known amongst indies. But it's definitely, there's pretty much no downside. I mean, you probably have to work out if you need a visa, for example. But that should be fairly simple because you're not earning money there, so it should be fine. Although I don't know much about that. I put a couple more photos from that. So this is my desk. For these 2 months, quite nice. There's a big lake in the background, so I was going swimming every day, so it's quite a nice work-life balance. That's Peter in the background. I couldn't exclude this shot, so there was also a sauna. so that was great. It was good. It's my walk to work. So definitely apply, and it's entirely free. You have to pay for the flight, so that's kind of expensive. But then 2 months, no costs, that's quite good. But it's kind of a little bit of a unicorn, so that I haven't seen anything comparable to this, so this is kind of not normal, I would say. So, but it's open, and it's just geared towards indies.
There are things similar to that.
Oh yeah.
For more from a like software development perspective, I'm sure they'd be open to game development.
Ah, that's interesting. So, do you know it by name?
There's one called Nomad House.
Nomad House, yeah.
And I think they were in Europe for a bit, in Southeast Asia for a bit. I don't think it's sponsored, so you still have to pay.
You have to pay, yeah. Yeah, there's a couple of weird, cool, nomadic things. There's also the co-boat, which is co-working on a boat, which is ridiculously expensive. So if you have like too much money, you can go there. But I think it's like 3,000 euros a month or something to live on a boat, and the boat cruises around the world. So. But you know, 3,000 is like more than a normal salary, so you will already have. I guess it's more for people who have like kind of a lot of seed funding or whatever, and they don't really need half of that. Anyway, so that all sounds really good, but there are a couple of downsides as well. So I'm going to talk now about like becoming a nomad, so kind of moving around from home, and kind of what the difficulties are. So there is. It might not be for beginners. So if you're just starting out to make a game and you have no income yet or kind of no funding secured, this will be very difficult. I mean, you can try to freelance. So like the main factor is cost, right? So if you move, it's going to be more expensive than staying home. I mean, if you limit yourself to third world countries, like to cheap countries like Southeast Asia especially, it can be very cheap, but then you need to figure out how to earn money, right? So if you have a game already, for example, that could work, so like you have some income, you have, or if you have some funding somewhere, or you do freelance work, or you could do go by savings, although that's kind of dangerous, because like you just eat up your savings and then you have nothing, in the worst case, right? So. So that's kind of a tricky thing to figure out, and I don't really know if there's an easy way to figure that out. So I'm living off the income from an Android game I made a while ago, so that kind of supports me for a while. But that's going down as well, so I need to make something new. And I don't know yet what exactly, so I'm trying this mind over, but that's kind of an odd beast, so we'll see if that works. Also, if you travel, there is a lot of distractions, right? So especially if you travel for short term. When I traveled a bit 2 years ago in India for a while, and there was always too much to see to focus on work, so I could basically nothing done. So like, and even if you're in a place for a while, you need the right kind of people around you as well. It's like when I was staying in one area, it's like just my friends who were made on the trip always said, hey, let's go out, like watch this temple or go to the beach or whatever. And I would usually say, yeah, sure. And then you get nothing done. And I mean, that's, in the short term, it's not so bad, because like if you're independent, then no one will look over your shoulder and say, ah, you didn't do anything. It just nothing happens. So it's kind of a dangerous feedback you get there. So you need to figure out how to keep the distractions low. And Colin Osway says he recommends slow travel. So like staying in a place for 3 months at a time, or 6 months if you can. So you kind of settle down, you see everything in the first week or so, and then you just work. You have a nice environment to work, right? So like maybe you're at the beach or something, or I don't know, on a tropical island. I don't know if that's possible. My internet is bad in islands, so. Another factor is loneliness. So loneliness can be quite a big factor, and it seems not so bad in the beginning, but the longer you travel, the more kind of on-the-road friendships you make, but they're all kind of very fleeting, very short-term. Like you make friends for 2 weeks at a time, add them on Facebook, and then basically you forget each other. Most of the time. So this can be very hard, especially if you don't have a partner to go with. Like, so Colin has his wife, so they go together, so that's nice. But and that kind of gets around this a bit. But otherwise, you estrange yourself as well a bit from your family and your friends at home, because they can't really relate to your lifestyle, right? So because they have their secure life at home, and you kind of just all over the place, and maybe you can't call them for a week or so. So this can be tricky, and one way to avoid this might be to go to these indie hotspots, kind of, or to try to travel with friends, although I haven't really managed that yet, so it's kind of, can be also tricky if you travel with your friends for 3 months at a time, so it really tests your friendship, and maybe it doesn't last. Another one which is tricky is culture. So this is a documentary called One Way Ticket. It's not out yet, so I just read about it the other day, and they say like most of these of nomads are kind of single white and male. So there's a kind of this cultural divide. So like because, for example, in Asia, people just they don't have the dialogue, so they don't really realize that this lifestyle is a possibility, right? So especially for example in Japan, everyone is working in the grind, and that's how it has to be, right? So then you have to find a job right after graduation. And if you skip a year, you will never get back into this kind of weird cochlear machine. So it's kind of a straight line to retirement, and it's kind of grueling, and very few people escape. So this is the cultural thing, and this documentary also speaks about this Korean couple, and their most important thing was, before they started on this journey, was to ask the permission from the parents. So the parents are like a huge part of their life. And obviously parents probably don't really like this idea of kind of having this totally unsecure and jump around lifestyle, so it's going to be a tricky thing. So visa troubles. It can be. It depends where you come from, which is kind of super unfortunate, and it's kind of hard to solve. So like, as a European, it's much easier to travel everywhere, and you get much more visas. But even like, for example, if you come from South Africa, there's like 100 countries you can visit without a visa. Mostly in the Southern Hemisphere, it seems. But apparently, like, Ireland is part of that, so you could go there. I don't know why, but it's interesting. But yeah, most of Europe isn't in America either, so that's kind of tricky. So you kind of need to change your focus. Southeast Asia is all cool, so that would work. Legal issues, I mean, I haven't really dealt with those much. It's kind of, the legal system can't really cope with nomads at the moment, so it's kind of too slow. But you basically go to Thailand, for example, or to Vietnam or whatever, to stay there 3 months and you work there, right? So technically you will need to pay tax, but no one knows, right? And the tax system hasn't caught up with kind of figuring that out or kind of limiting that. So it's kind of a gray zone, so there is issues with that. I mean, right now I guess the thing is just to ignore it. I mean, I'm not a lawyer, so that's not legal advice. if I'm gonna do that, I'm just gonna see what happens. Taxes can be an issue if you move somewhere long term. So like a couple of friends of mine recently moved from the UK to Berlin. And even though that's in the European Union, it can be tricky to figure out where you have to pay taxes, you know, avoid double taxation. All these boring topics, so you probably need to get a lawyer, and a lawyer is expensive, and especially if you don't make much money, it can be a bit tricky to do this the right way, right? Forming companies can be tricky if you don't have a home address. I think there's one thing in Estonia, they have like this e-passport for the e-citizens, where you don't really need a physical address, or I think they provide you one. But that would be an option. But I haven't done that, so I've got a company in the UK, and I've got an address in the UK, and I'll probably just keep that this way. So another option for creativity is shorter trips. And actually I'm running over time, so I'm gonna be a bit faster. So they're bad for productivity, but they're good for inspiration. For example, game jams. There is a lot of game jams that are not necessarily in your city, so like you can go to them. Like for some of the global game jam, which this was, they have places all over the world, so you could go to maybe just another town or another country if it's close and cheap enough. So that way you get like a different vibe, and like also like people you work with are different, and that way you get different kind of inspirations. And I want to pick out one game jam which I really like is the Exile Game Jam, which is in Denmark. It runs for 5 days, and only two of those days are actually in the jam. So the rest of the jam or the week is just kind of getting to know each other, getting drunk together, you know, making bonfires. So it's quite nice, quite relaxing. And that's actually where I made the line motor. So this is the first photo. So it's like much shorter, and like the spring is kind of super different. Like a shoe tree spring. I don't know if you know guys, but it's like from another shoe. And finally, there is the train jam, which I want to talk about briefly. So the train jam is an interesting beast. So if you're going to GDC, it might be worth it going. So this runs just before GDC. And it runs from Chicago to San Francisco, which is, I think, was it 5,000 kilometers? So it's a long distance. It's 52 hours, so two nights. And the jam basically runs the whole time. And so there's like the option to get beds and a shower. And it's not even that expensive for a train ride that long. I think it costs $300, including food. So for America, that's an okay price. So you have accommodation for you as well at that time. Yeah, and so that's quite a nice thing. So you get to travel and work on games at the same time. I mean, it's the landscape is kind of super distracting, but that's also a nice thing because you're not really making anything serious in that time. So it's a couple photos from us working on our weird games. We got some hardware controllers there, so I made these sliders like 2 years ago. Kind of weird other experiment that didn't really work out. That's how it looks going up the Sierra Nevada, I believe, so it's like a lot of bends. It's quite cool. And you can even do like hardware things on the train, although it's kind of a bit tricky with the soldering when the train moves. Yeah, I don't know if you can see this, like Rami and Adriel in the background. Adriel runs this train jam. So the next one is going to be just before GDC this year, so in March. Yeah, and that's kind of a little overview of kind of being away from home and traveling and making games or thinking about games. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks.